All right, if you're saved and you know it, shout amen. 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 Revival is starting this morning, and I'm going to testify for a minute just for fun, because I woke up in excruciating pain this morning at about 5 o'clock, excruciating. I was on my back, on my belly, rolling around, doing everything, got here. I said, I think I need to go to the ER. We go to the ER. I'm standing in line. I'm like, pain's gone. Amen. And then, on the way here, get a call. My daughter was in a head-on collision, car totaled, but she's all right. Amen. God's good. And I told Brother John here, he better have it, because if not, I think I could preach this one this morning. Come on, God's good, right? All right, God is good. So we have some announcements for you.
Okay, here's our Sunday school announcements. We had 79 in Sunday school, and you all are slipping. The teens had 77 in their offering.
I have a podcast on Spotify. It's called The Road to Salvation. It's a lot of testimonies from you guys in here. We have a lot of Bible studies. If y'all could, please give us a listen. Thank you.
April the 27th at Open Door Community Church at 6 o'clock, we're having a regional youth rally. If you have any questions or need details, just come see me.
On Friday, April 26th, we are having a young adult night in the Family Life Center. We'll play some games. It is a potluck, so there's a sign-up sheet on the welcome desk. You can see Mira Crystal for more details, and it starts at 6.
Amen. So the Point Park outreach yesterday did have to get postponed because of the flooding down there. So I will have a new date out for everyone soon. But on Wednesday, the 24th, Brother Ken will be coming down to Carrollton to minister on communion. And then we are going to partake of the Lord's Supper that evening with our Carrollton Mission family. So if you guys are able to come down, we'd love to have you join us for that night. And as always, if you can't be there, keep us in prayer.
Good morning, everybody. So April 1st, which is a Wednesday, first Wednesday of the month, we are having men's Bible study at, if you want to eat with us, we are providing food. That's going to be at 6, but if you just want to come for the Bible study, then that'll be at 6:30. We go over the series of with Tony Evans going over Kingdom Man. It's a great message. If all the men here, if you guys can make it out, April 1st, Wednesday, 6 o'clock, I'd like to see you guys there. Thank you. Not April Fool's, May 1st. I'm so sorry.
Okay, so May 4th, it is a Saturday at noon. We are going to do a bike blessing where we're going to ask a bunch of bikers to come and bring their bikes. We're going to pray over them and their motorcycles. We are actually going to be praying over the teens as well. So if you have a teen driver, encourage them to come that day. We are going to be praying over them, their driving skills, their cars, and then we're going to give them a prayer cloth to stick in their glove box to just take with them wherever they go. And then every Wednesday except for the first Wednesday of the month is women's prayer meeting. This Wednesday we're going to be in revival, so we will not. So the following Wednesday at 6 o'clock we'll do women's prayer meeting. And I just want to say I'm really proud of our teens. Like, we threw down a challenge for them to beat the middle schoolers and the adults in their tithes and offerings, and they are bringing it. So if you guys want to compete, you better bring it too.
All right, just because Michael got everybody mixed up here, it's Wednesday, May 1st at 6 o'clock. We will have women's Bible study as well. We have women's and men's. As he said, we will feed you before, and then at 6:30, Bible study will start. We are coming close to the end of our Proverbs 31 study with the women's Bible study. Please come out. We'd love to have you here.
Mind, Body, and Soul is an exercise class for anybody. It's on Mondays from 6 to 7. So come out, build your temple in the church, please.
To the ladies, this is the last day to sign up for the Mother's Day luncheon on May the 11th. So the sign-up sheet is out there. If you plan on attending, please sign up today. After today, the sign-up sheet will go away, and then we'll make plans on the food arrangements. Thank you.
So I'll stand, please, It is good to have the Carters here with us from the Kaywood Church of God. Looking forward to hearing them preach. Give them a hand clap, please. Preach both times today. Let's all come together and let's pray and invite our Lord into the service, please. Father, we are so thankful to be here this morning, so thankful for the miracles already performed. Thank you, God, for all the blessings you've given us this week. Father, we're praying for your spirit to settle in this place and do the things that only you are capable of doing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So we always like to start off, does anybody have a wedding anniversary or a birthday this past week? Anybody get any older? Been married longer? Yeah, there we go. Birthday? All right, let's sing Happy Birthday. Oh, happy birthday to you. Oh, happy birthday to you. Every day of the year, may you feel Jesus near. Oh, happy birthday to you. Oh, happy birthday to you. Have the best year you've ever had. Remember Brother Ken this morning? Henrietta had to take him to the emergency room. He's very sick, or else they'd be up here with us this morning. Amen. Just remember them in prayer. I'll fly away. Anybody making plans? Amen. I'll fly. And it could be, today. There's a lot going on in the world. Amen. And we need to be looking up because our redemption is drawing nigh. Amen. Amen. Well, some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. As you're seated.
All right, if we can have our ushers come forward, please. It is time to take up our tithes and our offerings. Give you a heads up. We are finally getting rid of the ugly awning out there. Amen. The permit came in today, so that'll... We're just going to recover it for now, seeing how the other project, triple in price, will do something a little bit simpler. I think Brother John knows about construction issues. Amen. So give as the Lord blesses you. And it really sounds like the teenage Sunday school class is really turning it up, making you adults look really bad. So you may want to kick it up a notch. Amen. Just to show them who's boss. Right? Amen. Let's pray. Father, we ask that you would take these tithes and offerings, bless them, multiply them, use them to further your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Who knows? Well, I hope everyone was expecting for everything to try to come crashing down around you for this morning. Amen. We know the enemy enough to know that he's going to do his best to fight. But we know our God enough to know that regardless of what the enemy throws our way, he's got us taken care of. So this morning, we can look at the enemy and just go, God is still going to get my praise. Amen. Amen.
God's gonna get my praise.
Amen. If you would stand. It's time for praise and worship. Amen. Not that we haven't already been doing that, but He does deserve all of our praise.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Open up the heavens, Lord. We want to see You.
For this day, we're gathered in Your name, calling out to You. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see You. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river. In this place, Your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, You're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see You. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from Your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see You. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from Your heart, filling every part of our praise. Show us Your glory. Show us Your power. Show us Your glory, Lord. Show us Your glory. Show us Your power. Show us Your glory, Lord. Open up the heavens. We want to see You. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from Your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see You. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from Your heart, filling every part of our
We do not have to be afraid because we are not alone. Amen. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I am not alone. He is my shepherd and He goes with me. Amen. And I follow Him. And He's going to lead me beside still waters and the green pastures. I'm going to tell you, it's been a week. But God. I was reading, I believe it was in Acts, and Paul was talking about the things that he was suffering. And he went on to say, but none of these things move me. And I have taken that stance this week because there was one, just it seemed like it was just one bad news after another. And I had, and it just continued on this morning. And then my daughter called, and I've been in a car accident. And I just said, none of these things move me. I know who my Redeemer is. Amen. And I am not afraid. Hallelujah. Because I know He's going to lead me and guide me in every situation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I have this confidence because I may not be in the right key. Let me start again. I have this confidence because I've seen the faithfulness of God, the steel inside the storm, the promise of the shore.
I trust the power of your word. Enough to seek your kingdom first, beyond the barren place, beyond the ocean waves. When I walk through the waters, I won't be overcome. When I go through the rivers, I will not be drowned. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. You keep the promises you made. There isn't one that is delayed, so I will not lose heart. Here I will lift my arms and start to sing into the night. My praise will cause the sun to rise, declare the battle won, declare that it is done. When I walk through the waters, I won't be overcome. When I go through the rivers, I will not be drowned. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. When I am in the fire, I will not feel the flame. I'll stand before the giant, declaring victory. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. Before me, behind me, always beside me. No shadow, no valley, where you won't find me. No, I am not afraid. I won't be overcome. When I go through the rivers, I will not be drowned. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. When I am in the fire, I will not feel the flame. I'll stand before the giant, declaring victory. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. Before me, behind me, always beside me. No shadow, no valley, where you won't find me. No, I am not afraid. No, I am not afraid. Before me, behind me,
he's always
beside
me. Oh, there's no shadow,
no valley, where you won't find me. No, I am not afraid. No, I am not afraid. My God will make.
He's always, always with us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Have you ever just wanted to throw your hands up and just worship just unabandoned? Like there's just nothing stopping you. Amen. Freely just give him praise. Amen. We welcome that. Amen. Hallelujah.
Something isn't adding up. this wild exchange you offer us. I gave my worst, you gave your blood. Seems hard to believe. You're telling me you chose a cross. You're telling me I'm worth that much. Well, if that's the measure of your love, how else would I sing?
But completely, deeply, sold out, sincerely abandoned. I'm completely, freely, hands to the ceiling enamored. My one life endeavor to match your surrender, to mirror not my will but yours. I'm completely, deeply, don't care who sees me abandoned. Oh, I surrender. I just can't get over it. What kind of self-control is this? You had angels at your fingertips, but on the cross you remained. Well, I can't repay this kind of love, but I can praise with everything I've got. Since death had all its power robbed, well then just like the grave, yeah, I'm completely, deeply sold out, sincerely abandoned. I'm completely, freely, hands to the ceiling in amber. My one life endeavor to mirror not my will but yours. I'm completely, deeply, don't care who sees me abandoned. Oh, I surrender all. I surrender all. I breath in my lungs, consider it yours, Lord. Consider it yours, Lord. The failures I hide, the victories I don't, the battles I fight, each crown that I hoard, consider it yours, Lord. Consider it yours. Consider it yours, Lord. Consider it yours. I'm completely, deeply sold out, sincerely abandoned. I'm completely, freely, hands to the ceiling in amber. Oh, I surrender all. I surrender all. I surrender all. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Amen. Children's Church. You may be dismissed. Continue to worship as the Word of God comes forward to be preached this morning by Brother John Carter. Amen.
Come on up, sir. I'll let you introduce yourself.
Amen. What a spirit of worship in the house today. Amen. There is just a sweet, thank you. There's just a sweet spirit in the house. And we never want to take that for granted. Amen. We want to reverence that and thank God for it. I want to say that it is an honor to be with you today. We come from the Kaywood Church of God. That is in Harlan County. That is about as far southeast of the state as you can get. We are on the Tennessee-Virginia border, and I probably talk a little funny to some of you, so you'll have to just bear with me. Whatever you do after church, don't come up and just ask me to start talking. That happens sometimes. People just like to hear us talk. Well, I like to hear y'all talk. Y'all sound as funny to me as I do to you. But it truly is an honor to be here with you. I know your pastor has already said that he had a couple of things going on this morning, and again, I praise God for the healing that took place in his body while waiting in the emergency room. I still believe in healing. Amen. I thank God that his daughter is all right. I believe angels were encamped around about her today. Amen. Cars can be replaced. People can't. And we praise the Lord for Pastor Wayne and his wife and family and the church family. We've heard nothing but good things about you here at Mission Church of God. And we have enjoyed our visit here in northern Kentucky, you bunch of northerners. But thank you for having us. I'm just going to share my heart with you today. Woke straight up this morning, eyes opened, and it dawned on me. I left my church clothes at home. So thank God for Target. My wife ran over to Target and found me a shirt that don't fit and a tie that doesn't either. So if you'll give me just a minute, I'm going to loosen one of them. I'll spare the details of the other, but I'm going to loosen one of them. She said, "Honey, don't sweat today. We can take that shirt back." No promises. Because when I get to talking about God and his goodness, I get a little bit excited. When I get to thinking about what he's done for me and how he saved my soul from hell, I don't need something to move on me to shout. I can shout just thinking about what God's already done. If he doesn't do another thing, he's done enough. Praise the Lord. I'm so glad to have my wife, Leanne, with me this December. It's still a while. This December, we will celebrate 20 years of marriage, and we dated two. So she has put up with me for 22 years, and I'm thankful for her. I couldn't do what I do without her. I'm thankful to have my son, who is 18 years old. I kind of got in trouble at the hotel. They said, "Do you have children?" I said, "Two." And then I thought, wait a minute, one, but two, but one. One just turned 18, so I don't guess he's technically a child anymore, but he'll always be a child to me. He's my son, and I'm thankful for him. He's my namesake, and he is serving the Lord, working on the worship team. And Pastor Wayne, it won't be long, you'll be interviewing him with CAMS, and I think he's going to go through CAMS and get credentialed because there's a calling on his life, and I'm thankful for that. Amen. 2 weekends ago, he was on the floor at Rupp Arena playing for a state championship. Two Saturdays ago, playing on Saturday evening for a state championship, came up just short, finished runner-up in the state, and he's a light to his ball team, and he's a light to his coaches and his friends, so I'm thankful for that. Thankful for my daughter, Leah Kate. She is the apple of my eye. She is my little girl. I'm sure there's some boys that would like to go with her, but they can't. So when I'm dead, they can, but until then, they cannot. And not only am I her dad and her pastor, I am, God bless her heart, I am her principal. I am a principal of an elementary and middle school, K through eight school back home, public school. God has given me the opportunity to be the administrator of that school, and I'm thankful for that too. So I just wanted to visit with you for just a minute. Enough about me. Let's get to talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. And salvation is the greatest thing ever known to man. Would you agree with that? Salvation. A couple weeks ago, we celebrated Easter. Amen. We celebrated the week before that, we celebrated Palm Sunday, where Jesus comes in riding on a borrowed donkey. Amen. Wasn't even his. It was borrowed, and he goes riding through town. And all the people were shouting Hosanna, and they were waving palm branches, and they were laying their garments in the road, and they were shouting Hosanna, and they were giving him praise and giving him glory. Hosanna, we all know, means save us. And there's still days that I shout Hosanna. Amen. Save me, O God. Save me from this wicked world that we're in. And they were giving praise to him, and they were blessing his name. Amen. But a day or two later, we find where Jesus went into the church house, and he had to cleanse it, and he had to turn over some tables. Anybody read that part? Everybody likes the Hosanna and the blessing and the honor and the glory, but nobody likes the part where he has to come in and find that they're not doing things in the house of God the way things ought to be done. Amen. So he turns over their tables and he kicks them out. Amen. He says, you've made it a den of thieves. This is the house of prayer. You're doing things that you ought not be doing. And to make a long story short, the same people that were praising him and shouting Hosanna, amen, just a few days ago, amen, a week later, they were now yelling crucify, amen. So what I'm telling you is, don't be flattered by people, the things people say to you, because all it does is take one disagreement and they're ready to turn on you. But I'm glad today, amen, that Jesus went to the cross, amen. He went to the cross that Friday. He hung on that beam. He hung on that old rugged cross, and he died. I don't know how long he was there. Amen. Somebody said, Pastor, you know he was only 6 inches off the ground. I said, brother, no disrespect, but I don't care if he was 6 inches or 6 feet off the ground. The only thing I care is that he hung there and he stayed there and he didn't come down from there, all because he loved me. Amen. He died. They put him in a tomb, another borrowed tomb. He didn't need it for himself. It was just borrowed for a few days. Man, and we know the story. On Sunday morning, they showed up to the graveyard looking for somebody alive. Amen. You don't always go to a graveyard looking for people who are living, right? When we go to the graveyard, we go to visit those who have deceased. But I like what the angel of the Lord said. Why seek ye the living among the dead? He's not here. He has risen just like he said he would. So I'm glad today as well that I serve a risen Savior. So I'm glad for salvation. I'm glad that he saved me. On Wednesday night, March the 13th, 1996, at about 9 o'clock, in the altar of the church in which I now pastor, amen, he gloriously saved this 16-year-old boy from his sin. Amen. He called me. I'm not an entertainer. I'm not here to tickle your ears. I am a gospel preacher. I believe in the anointing. I believe in the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And I'm here to because he called me to preach after he saved me. Salvation is wonderful. On Sunday morning, March the 31st, at about 11:30 in the morning, I was baptized in water. Amen. I followed the Lord Jesus Christ into baptism, and I was baptized in water. Amen. And I'm thankful for water baptism. I think it is still necessary for the church today to practice water baptism. And I'm thankful that on that day I was baptized in water. But the reason I came to preach to you that God dropped into my heart, amen, that a few months after that, on a Sunday night, on October the 6th, in 1996, I had just turned 17. Amen. And the saints of God, back in the day, they would always tell you when you got saved, now, you need the Holy Ghost. Let me stop a minute. A lot of folks believe that you get it all at conversion. If that's the case, I want to know where it is with some people. Amen. I read, and I'll let your pastor do that on his own time, because that's more of a pastoral message. Amen. There is an indwelling of the Spirit. When the spirit of evil leaves you and the Spirit of God comes in, when you repent, when you're converted, yes, you have the Spirit of the Lord inside of you. Amen. But I read in Acts chapter number 9 where Saul had an experience while he was walking down the road. And a light shone out of heaven and said, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And Saul, to make a long story short, Saul went blind, and God, Jesus Christ, changed his name from Saul to Paul, and he was converted right on the spot, and he went from a sinner to a saint just like that. But something happened 3 days later. He was baptized in the Holy Ghost. There's a difference in the indwelling and the baptism and the infilling, if you will. There's a difference in the indwelling and the infilling. Amen. I thought we got it all at conversion. Acts chapter number 19. Paul says to the disciples. Somebody say disciples. So he said to the disciples, and I'm going somewhere. Just bear with me for just a moment. He said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? In other words, that tells me there is another blessing that is waiting on the children of God. Amen. And you know what they said? We didn't even know whether there be any such thing as a Holy Ghost. Amen. He said, well, then with whose baptism were you baptized? They said, we were baptized with John's baptism. He said, oh, yeah, I understand now. You've been baptized in water unto repentance. He said, but there's a baptism that's coming. Amen. And you're going to be filled with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And the Bible says he laid hands on them and they spake with tongues, which was indicative, which was a sign and a signal that they received the other blessing. So I'm here to tell you today, if you've never been filled with the Holy Ghost, I see your declaration of faith on the wall. Article number 8 says that this church believes in the baptism in the Holy Ghost subsequent to a clean heart. I'm here to tell you. So article number 9 says that we believe within speaking with other tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance. I'm here to tell you today, if you've never been filled in the Holy Ghost, I believe today is your day to be filled with His Spirit. Acts chapter number 1, verse number 8. This is the premise on everything that we as a church concerning the Holy Ghost believes in. This is our go-to scripture. Now, what are you going to preach from? Well, in a minute, I'm going to preach from Acts chapter 2. Everybody's like, oh, we know that. But I hope I can give it to you in a way maybe that's a little different than you've ever heard it. It says, but you shall receive. What's that word? You shall receive what? Now, before you can have power, you have to give up being. If you're going to be powerful, you've got to give up being pitiful. If you're going to have His power, you have to relinquish the pity. If you're going to have His power, then you have to relinquish being a nobody. Poor pitiful me. We read in the book of John where the lame man for 38 years couldn't be healed because nobody would put him in the water when the water was stirred. Amen. You know why? Because his eyes were on the wrong thing. There was no power in the water. Jesus shows up. You can read it for yourself. I think it's John chapter 5, verses 1 through 9. Jesus shows up and asks the man, do you even want to get better? That's the first thing I want to ask you today. Do you even want the power? Because I'm telling you, to receive the power, there's a price to be paid for the power and for the anointing. You see, back home, where I come from, there's hills and hollers and mountains. Anybody know what a holler is? Some of you was raised in a holler. Mountain here, barely enough room to fit a house. Right in the middle of it at the bottom. We have hollers. We have hills. We're a bunch of hicks. Hillbillies. You're looking at one. Proudly. I'm thankful for my heritage. Because back home, you either go to church or you're the polar opposite. You either serve God or you're a devil. There's no middle ground. But I'm thankful for my heritage. I'm thankful that in those hollers, those old men and women of a bygone era, amen, they knew how to get a hold of God. I'm glad that they knew when nothing else could go right, God could step in and change it all at once. I'm glad that prayer was their first resort and not their last. I'm glad, brother, that they left mantles lying around. There are mantles on top of mantles. Some of you have grandparents and parents and great-grandparents who were good, godly people, and their mantles are lying on the ground. And we say, why won't people pick them up? It's because people don't want to pay the price to carry the power. Amen. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses. Let me say this. A lot of people want this power. A lot of people, you're gonna get your pay today, boy, chasing me all over this place. I might end up back there later. I don't know. But anyway, amen. A lot of people want this power. They want the Holy Ghost so that they can feel the goosebump, or they can feel something on the inside of them, or so that they can speak in a language that they've never been trained to speak in, or that they can jump up and down, or they can run the aisle, or they can hop on the seats. I tell you where we come from. Sometimes we get up on the chairs. Amen. When this power, but let me tell you what the power's given you to you for. It is not so you can feel something. It is not so you can run and jump and dance and fall and scream and yell and hack and holler. That's not why you were given the power. You were given the power so that you could be witnesses. That when you're in the bread aisle at Target and somebody needs to hear about Jesus, amen, the Holy Ghost will give you the words to say at the same hour that will bear witness with those people. He said you'll receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, which means right in your own living room. We've got to be able to win our own people. Before you go on this trip of winning the world, you've got to live. You've got to win the people on the chair next to you. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria. When you start using this power to win the people around you, then God will start sending you around this world to tell people about what he does. Now let me keep going, because I can't wait to come. I'm more excited about preaching to you tonight than I am this morning, because tonight we're going to talk about what happens after you get the Holy Ghost. Today we're going to get the Holy Ghost. Tonight we're going to come back and learn what we do once we have the Holy Ghost. Amen. So then we turn to Acts chapter 2. Any good Pentecostal can quote it without looking. Amen. Acts chapter 2. I think I gave it to her. Verse number 1. I got a lot of scripture, but I don't know. We'll get to it when we do, if we do. Amen. But in Acts chapter 2, verse number 1, we find, amen, that when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. They were all. Everybody say all. Say all. Say all. They say if you say it 3 times, it'll get in there. So all of them, they were all in one accord. All of them. Now, the tongues as a fire was a miracle. The sound of heaven was a miracle. The speaking with other tongues was a miracle. All these things were miracles. But one of the greatest miracles to me in this entire chapter is the fact that 120 people could get together in one accord. They didn't care what color the carpet was. They didn't care if the awning was ugly. Amen. They didn't care if the pews were padded or if they were hardbacks. They didn't care. You know why they didn't care? Because he said, I want you to tarry in Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. There's that word again, power. He said, I want you to wait in Jerusalem. I don't want you to leave. I want you to stay there. I want you to stay there because when you stay there and when you tarry, he said, I'm going to give you power. I'm going to endue you with power from on high. They started asking questions. Is this the time you're going to do this or is this the time you're going to? He said, it's not for you to know the time nor the season. And that's when he went in, but you shall receive power. Verse 8 of 1. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. But let me read you this real quickly. In 1 Corinthians, I'm going to sum up 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 6. You don't even got to turn there. He said, let me remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news I preached to you before. You welcomed it then, and you still stand firm in it. It is the good news that saves you if you continue to believe the message I told you. Unless, of course, you believe something that was never true in the first place. He said, I passed on to you what was most important and what had been passed down to me. He said, Christ died for our sins, just as the scripture said. He was buried. He was raised from the dead on the third day, just as the scripture said. And he was seen by Peter and by the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 followers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. He said, at one time, he was seen by 500 or more. So we're going to use the number 500. I spent 10 years in the classroom before I became a principal, and I taught English and reading and language arts. I did not teach math. I hate math with a passion. And those of you who can do math, I don't get you. I don't understand anything about you. I don't know why they put letters in math. Math is for numbers, not letters. I don't care why X, Y, and Z did whatever. But he was seen of 500. So we're going to say 500 people were told, tarry in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. You fast forward to Acts chapter 2, verse number 1, and you find that when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, but it wasn't 500 anymore. It was now 120. Because somewhere between the command to tarry and the time to meet, some folks got impatient on the power. They got impatient on the promise. Some scholars, some theologians, some commentators say that it was a 10-day period from the time he said to wait to the time they went to the upper room. 10 days. Anybody can do anything for 10 days, right? Apparently, help me with math, he spoke to 500, 120 stuck around. How many went home? 300 and, I mean, she's a walking calculator. I mean, she spit that out faster than I could get the words out. 380 people went home between the command to tarry and the time of the fulfillment of the promise. 120 people stuck around and said, you know what? If we're going to get this power and we're going to possess this power and we're going to receive this promise, then we're going to stick around. You know what they did? Listen to me, young people. You need to hear this. You know what they did? They didn't go to church. They didn't go to a crusade. They didn't go to a conference. They didn't go to a camp meeting. They didn't go to a crusade, they didn't go to a conference, and they didn't go to a camp meeting. You know where they went? They went to prayer meeting. Nobody wants to talk about prayer meeting. Everybody's good with Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. But when you call a Tuesday at 5:30 prayer meeting, I'll tell you, that's the church. The ones who show up for prayer meeting. 380 of them went home. 120 of them stuck around because they wanted the promise of the Father. So they went upstairs. They went upstairs to a prayer meeting. Amen. They went to the upper room. The Bible says they went to the upper room and they started to pray. They started to seek God. And they said, we've got to have this promise. We've got to possess this promise. So 120 on the day of Pentecost came together in one accord in one place. My God, what could happen if we could all get together in one accord in one place? The things we could accomplish if we could all get together in one accord and in one place. Let me tell you right now, what the 120 people did not do. Y'all don't have any windows. That's a window, isn't it? Okay. I can tell you what they didn't do. They didn't go to the window and look out the window and think, oh, where did the rest of them go? Where did the rest of them go? I wish they would come back. They wasn't wringing their hands, wondering and thinking, how are we going to do this? No, no, no. They said, if they don't want what God's got for them, we're going to stick around and get what God's got. I'm telling somebody today, you showed up at the right place at the right time because God is about to give you the promise of the Father. So they went to prayer meeting. Amen. Went upstairs. They shut the door. They started praying. They started seeking the Lord. And the Bible tells us in verse 2 that when they got to the place where they needed to be, that suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. I said, and suddenly there came a sound from where? There came a sound from where? I'm an audience participation preacher. There came a sound from where? We need to hear from heaven again. We need to hear from heaven again. There came a sound from heaven. Amen. We need to hear from heaven again. I'm tired of hearing from CNN. I'm tired of hearing from Fox News. I'm tired of hearing from Instagram. I'm tired of hearing from Facebook. I'm tired of hearing from Twitter. I don't really care who the next coach is. We need to hear from heaven again. We need to gather in one accord, in one place, with one thing on our mind, and that is to hear from heaven. They heard from heaven. It was the sound of a rushing mighty wind. God, young people, I don't know where you attend school. I don't know where you go to hang out. But you know what I want for you? I want God to give you this power. Listen to me, young adults. Listen to me, people. Even the elderly, even the middle-aged people. I'm talking to all of you. But for some reason, I feel compelled to the younger generation for just for a few moments, if you will. I want you to be so full of His power that your friends take notice that there's something different about you. That there's something in you that is doing something to them. Man, I want you young people to get a hold of this because it's what's going to keep you. In this last hour, there came a sound from heaven. It was a rushing mighty wind. It filled all the house. Verse 3. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues as a fire, and it sat on each of them. Each one of them had a tongue of fire that sat just above their heads. It was a tongue that was a flame of fire that sat on 120 heads. You know what this tongue of fire was for? That when they come downstairs from the prayer meeting,
that everywhere they went, everybody they met, every person they came encounter with, they would preach and teach and talk with the fire of God that penetrates the hearts. They wasn't looking out the window for the 380. Their mentality was, if you don't want this, I still do. Listen to me. Don't follow the crowd. Don't follow the crowd. I am not savvy in math, but I do know that 380 is more than 120. And a lot of people would have thought, if that many people are going home and don't feel that this is very necessary or needful, then I think I will too. And I'm afraid we've got a generation that follows the crowd. Just because everybody else is going this way, they're going to go this way. Just because everybody else is doing this, they're going to do this. The 120 said, we might be the minority, but we're going to receive the promise of the Father. There appeared unto them cloven tongues. You, if you've been filled with the Holy Ghost, you have a tongue of fire. I said, you have a tongue of fire. What's the fire got to do with anything? I don't care what it is. You set something on fire, it doesn't sit still. Amen? It'll crackle, it'll pop, it'll dance, it'll jump, it'll do something. When the fire gets a hold of a piece of paper, it's going to crackle and crinkle, and it's going to jump and leap because it's on fire. Amen. I'm here to tell you, I'm just Pentecostal enough. I'm just holler hick and hillbilly enough to believe that when the fire of God gets on you, you won't just sit there. Amen. You won't be dignified and polished. You'll do whatever He tells you to do. He wasn't done. Verse 4. And they were all, somebody say all, filled with the Holy Ghost. My God, help me, Jesus. They began to speak with other tongues. It's the Spirit gave them the utterance. There's a doctrine of the devil that's going around this world today that says tongues and prophecy and interpretation of tongues and the gift of healing and the casting out of devils ceased. It's called the cessationalist doctrine. It says it ceased with the apostles and with the disciples. But I got news for you. It is as real today as it ever has been. Preacher, you've lost your mind. I've been called worse. It's as real today as it ever has been. Amen. They all were filled with the Holy Ghost. Not just a few of them. All of them. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And spake with tongues as the Spirit gave them the utterance. Go down to verse 12. Look. They were all amazed and were in doubt, saying one to another, what meaneth this? Next verse. Others mocking said, these men are full of new wine. They're drunk. They've been drinking a little bit too much. Because they heard what was going on in the prayer meeting. They didn't hear what was going on in the crusade or the camp meeting or the conference. But they heard what was going on in the prayer meeting. The impromptu prayer meeting. The prayer meeting that wasn't planned. I would to God that we would get some spontaneity back in us. You know, a spontaneous praise. When you're in the ER line and the pain just dissipates, a spontaneous praise rises up in you and you don't care. You sung about it. I don't care who sees me. I don't care who knows about it. I'm going to praise Him no matter what comes. I'm going to praise Him. We need spontaneous praise. I tell it just about wherever I go. Pastor Wayne, we were having Harlan County Church of God camp meeting. There is a Church of God on every corner in Harlan County. There were 14 churches at that time that met for 1 week, usually in April or May. And we had 1 week of Church of God, Harlan County Church of God prayer. I'm telling you what, everything you've heard about Pentecost in the mountains is true. Yeah, what you're thinking is true. Yeah, you're thinking, I wonder if we do. No snakes. No, we do not do that. Some do, we don't. We're of the tribe who don't. Church of God camp meeting, Harlan County style, baby. Amen. Everybody's coming out of the nooks and crannies. Everybody's coming to town. Because it was at the Harlan Church of God. It was in the city of Harlan. Don't blink, you'll miss it. But to some people, it was a big deal. We all come together. 14 Pentecostal holiness, Holy Ghost believing churches. Woo, I feel it just talking about it. Came together for 1 week. Nobody cared whose church was the biggest. Nobody cared whose church had the most money. All they knew is that they come in with two things on their mind. We Church of God to the bone, and we're going to sing about it. Amen. Uh-huh. They got together. They had a meeting. This church is going to do this on this night, and this church is going to take care of the music on this night, and this church is going to take care of the children's church on this night, and this church is going to be the altar committee on this night, and this church is going to be the offering committee on this night, and this church, this pastor is going to open in scripture, and this pastor is going to do this on this night, and this pastor is going to do that on that night. Now, I believe everything should be done decently and in order, but I also believe you can order God plumb out of the arrangements. Brother J.G. Hackler, he pastored the Church of God at Wallens for 155 years. The district overseer at the time said, "Does anybody have any questions?" This was a meeting among the pastors. Pastor Hackler raised his hand, just an old country feller. "Yes, Brother Hackler, what is your question?" He said, "What are you boys aiming to do if the Spirit moves?" Y'all know what aiming to do means? Let me reword that. What is your plan if the Holy Ghost shows up and it ain't my turn to do something, but the Holy Ghost tells me to? Anybody know what I'm talking about? We had a church. This was back in 96, 97. We had a church called the New Hope Church of God. Dr. McKinley Underwood was the pastor. Amen? Brother Underwood and Sister Underwood. They were black folks. And a majority of their congregation was. And I'm telling you what, boy, when it was New Hope's night to sing, people showed up. They didn't need your pianer. They didn't need your guitar. Well, one night it wasn't New Hope's turn to sing. Did you hear me? It wasn't New Hope's turn to sing. And in the back pew, her name was Sister Cowser. Black sister that wore a hat to church, walked on a cane. She had a lazy eye. It wasn't their turn to sing. And I was sitting about where you are. She was sitting on that back wall. And I heard something. And suddenly there was a sound out of heaven.
I feel it right now.
I said, there was a sound from heaven. It was Sister Kalser. I got my program, my little trifolded brochure that told me who was going to do what and when they were going to do it. We'll pretend it was a Tuesday night special singing. Let me just tell you about special singing in the Pentecostal church. Some of it is special. I looked at my program because when I heard, I was like, oh my God, I don't think it's our turn. I was getting real nervous. But then I looked and it wasn't her turn. And I looked behind me. I dared to look behind me for a good 15 seconds. Felt like 2 hours. And I heard it again. And I saw her stand to her feet in her 70s on a walking cane, could barely walk by herself. She had that hat on and a lazy eye. And I heard, I sing because I'm happy. Like, my God. She made her way to the front. On that walking cane, I sing because I'm free. When she got to the front, it was right on time. She said, because his eye is on the sparrow. Let me just say, there was a sound out of heaven on that night. That church came unglued. The power of the Holy Ghost filled all the house where they were sitting, and the glory of God had showed up. You know what I did with my program? I threw it in the wind. I said, because his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he's watching me. She danced all around that front. She went back to her seat and sat down. Because she was obeying the Lord. Let me say again, everything should be decently and in order. But when she took the floor, it was certainly in order. Because we heard a sound out of heaven. We need to hear that sound come out of heaven one more time. Because if you're watching what's happening in Jerusalem, I plead with you, if you're not born again, this is not a scare tactic, this is reality. Iran has started bombing Israel, Jerusalem, out of nowhere. Amen. Allies of Israel and their own equipment is intercepting these missiles. They can say all they want to, but I'm telling you what is intercepting the missiles. The hand of Almighty God. Because he said, I will bless them who bless you. I will curse them who curse you. So I plead with you, if you're not saved, you better get in while the getting's good. Amen. Let me finish because I can't wait to get back tonight. A lot of people probably thought Sister Kalser was drunk. Well, she was. Staggering drunk. And it wasn't because she needed a cane. It's because the Holy Ghost was in her legs. And then the Holy Ghost got in her arms. And then the Holy Ghost got in her head. And then the Holy Ghost got in her mouth. Yeah. Let's go. Verse 14. But Peter,
Peter, the Pentecostal preacher, standing up with the 11, lifted his voice and said, "You men of Judea, indeed, though that dwell in Jerusalem, be it known unto you and hearken to my words. For these men are not drunk as you suppose, being seeing it but the third hour of the day." He said, "But this is that." This is that. You know what's happening right here in this church today? This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, verse 17. Amen. And it's saying, "It shall come to pass in the last day, saith God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh." Pastor Wayne, every morning when I wake up, I say, "Now, Lord, I declare unto you today that my son and my daughter shall prophesy. You lay hands on your babies. You lay hands on your grandbabies, and you declare that they shall prophesy." Did you hear me? They shall prophesy. No. They're not going to run the roads. They're not going to do the things of the world. They're not going to be out here drinking and drugging and fornicating. No. You declare things over them. You declare things over them. I'm telling you right now, no's an answer. Tell them no from time to time. Amen. You lay hands on them. Church is not an option. Did you hear me? Church is not an option. They shouldn't have to ask, "Are we going to church on Sunday?" They should know the answer before they even ask it. You get them in the presence of God, because I'm telling you, 5 days out of the week, they're in the presence of the world. I mean, that poor old school in Harlan's got a Pentecostal tongue-talking Church of God preacher leading their school, and I know there's still sin in the camp. We got to protect and lay hands on and rebuke the devourer off of... When that sister said that the teenage class gave $77, now hold on a minute. You might think that's crazy, but do you know how to get the devourer off of you? You bring your tithe and your offering into the storehouse. That's what the Bible says. And he said, "When you do that, I'll rebuke the devourer." You teach your children to give. Whew. That's free, Pastor. Y'all gonna see visions. I said, y'all going to see visions. So you going to see visions. You going to wake up in the middle of the night and tell somebody what God showed you. And I'm going to tell you this. If this middle age, I'm including myself, and this older generation is not going to lead the way, young people, you get up and lead this thing the way it's supposed to be led. Amen. Listen to me, elders. I love you. I thank God for you. I don't worship my elders, but I cherish my elders. I'm thankful that I was taught songs like "It Is No Secret What God Can Do." What he's done for others, he'll do for you. With arms wide open, he'll pardon you, because it is no secret what God can do. I'm thankful that when I got in the altar and prayed after salvation, I'm thankful that them grandmas would get down beside of me and whisper in my ear, "You worship him, you praise him, you glorify him, you lift your hands to heaven, you keep praising him until your praise turns into tongues." I'm thankful for Sister Cowsers that said, "I know I'm not on the program, but I'm on God's program." Amen. I'm thankful. I'm thankful for those of you who have taught Sunday school, amen, who have done the work in the church that needed to be done. Amen. But young people, it's time to lead the way. It's time to be leaders and not followers. Amen. It's time to stop following the ways of sin and the ways of the world and get back to following the things of God and leading your friends to a relationship with him. I'm 18. I'm about to close. Whoever plays the piano, come on, brother. And on my servants and on my handmaidens, I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. He said, and I'll show you wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and a vapor of smoke. Real quickly, skip down to verse 37. Real quickly. And when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart. They said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Now Peter said unto them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For this promise is unto you and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call." My grandparents were Church of God preachers, pastors. My grandfather was converted at 14. He was in the middle of 11 children. He was smack dab in the middle. 5 younger, 5 older. None of them served the Lord. Long story short, he went to a revival they were having at the age of 14. He went to a revival they were having at a schoolhouse. And he gave his heart to Jesus at 14 years old. Mom and dad were not Christians. Brothers and sisters, 10 of them were not Christians. He knew nothing about God. He knew nothing about Jesus. He knew nothing about the church. He said he went to church the first night, prayed in the altar, got up, didn't feel a thing. He said he went back the second night, prayed in the altar, got up, no change. I still believe we got to pray through. You may know what I mean by that? Pray through. Pray through. And he told me, he said, "Honey, on that third night, I knew something was different." He said, "Because when I got up out of that altar, I looked over in the corner, and about on the third row, there was a man that I had stolen water from, and God told me to go make it right with him." He said, "It was right then I knew something had changed inside of me." That's what God does. Saved at 14. God called him to preach at 17. Pastored his first church at 19 when his pastor died of a heart attack on the riverbank at a baptismal service. The overseer at the time called and said, "Brother Farmer, you are the new pastor at Gulston. Congratulations." 19. The Lord started calling him. He pastored churches from Paducah to Pikeville and several places in between. My great-great-grandmother fried pies. You know what I'm talking about? Glory, I felt the glory. She fried pies to help keep the doors open at the Gulston Church of God. My great-grandmother fried chicken to keep the doors open at the same church. And then my grandmother and grandfather pastored that same church, and then God said, "Listen to me, folks. This promise is not just for you. It's for your children and your children's children. And as many as the Lord our God shall call, it's for you all." And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, "Save yourselves from this untoward generation." Verse 41. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. All because the Spirit of God filled them all. If you're here today, it is his desire to fill you. The goosebumps and the running and the dancing and the shouting and the hooping and the hollering are all cherries on top. But he's going to endue you with power. You shall receive power so that you can be witnesses unto him. So that when that Holy Ghost anointing gets on you like it did Sister Kowser,
it'll be in order, because it'll bear witness with the people. If you'll notice, the Holy Ghost came and people were saved. 3,000 souls were added because the Holy Ghost came. I want to know today, and we're going to come back tonight, and we're going to finish this part that I've got for you. I saw the lineup of preachers. Thank you for putting me first and not last. Because you've got a lineup of preachers that, in the words of our general overseer, I feel like a mule at the Kentucky Derby compared to these brothers that are coming to you this week to preach to you. But I want to do my part. And we're going to come back, Lord willing, tonight, and we're going to talk about what we do once the party's over. Once the dismissal prayer in the upper room was amen and they came downstairs, now what? Now what? Now you've spoken with tongues and you've been filled with the Spirit. Now what? It's not just for you to continue doing what you... Now what? There's work to be done. There's lives to be... There's people out there waiting for you and your testimony. Now what? Stand all over this house if you can. First and foremost, if you're not saved or you're backslidden, I came up here today for you. And if you don't know Jesus in a free pardon of sin, I'm not talking about a decision you made at 5 and sprinkled when you were 6. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about an encounter where you are saved from your sin. And there is a change that takes place. You no longer see things the way you saw them. Amen. You're here today and maybe you don't know. Maybe you've grown cold. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You're here today and you've never been baptized in the Holy Ghost. I want you to join me in this altar. I just want you to come stand right here in this altar. Pastor, on October the 6th of 96, I didn't have the Holy Ghost. Brother, every altar call they gave, I didn't care if it's for a stump toe or a whatever, I was up there praying for the Holy Ghost. And back then, there was a minister who preached on the baptism in the Holy Ghost. And he didn't come blow on me. He didn't come push me down. He didn't come jerk me to the ground. He just came and laid his hand so ever gently on my head and prayed that I would receive the baptism. And immediately, I was filled with the Holy Ghost. You have to yield your members to his Spirit. Now, these folks have come to this front and they're desiring to be endued with power. They want to receive power. They want to be filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm going to tell you what they always told me growing up. I need people who do have the Holy Ghost to come up here and get behind them and pray with them and pray for them. So if you've been filled with the Holy Ghost, this is not optional. If you are able, I need you to come. And I need you to get behind these folks, and I want us to pray together that God fill these folks with the Holy Ghost and with power and with fire. I believe he's here to do that today. I believe he's here to do that today. I don't believe anybody has to leave disappointed. Come on, you just lift your hands right now and you start praising. You start praising. You start praising. You just start praising him and honoring him. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, folks, let's pray with them. Come on, Father, in the name of Jesus.
All my hands have made, I'm laying down. All that I hold dear, my many.
I've tasted and seen of your great love. You satisfy me. You satisfy. My constant request above all things, every hour I wake, be near me, oh God. I've tasted and seen of your great love. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. Spirit, fall. Leave me amazed. Show off your glory. Let heaven invade. We're waiting with worship. We're waiting with praise for the almighty presence of God to invade. Spirit, fall. Open up heaven's doors. We're waiting with worship for more. You're the only love that satisfies me. And Lord, we run into your loving arms. We're safe and secure in your love. You're the only love that satisfies me. Leave me astounded. Leave me amazed. Show off your glory. Let heaven invade. We're waiting with worship. We're waiting with praise for the almighty presence of God to invade. Oh, leave me astounded. Leave me amazed. Show off your glory. Let heaven invade. We're waiting with worship. We're waiting with praise for the almighty presence of God to invade. Spirit, fall. Open up heaven's doors. We're waiting with worship for You're the only love that satisfies me.
life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, and all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Saints, we still have people in the altar. We want them to stay there. We are coming back tonight, okay? And first morning, preaching about the Holy Ghost. Tonight, there's more Holy Ghost. Monday, more Holy Ghost. Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. That's what it's all about. So if you didn't get it this morning, come ready tonight. Amen. If you haven't done any fasting, do some fasting. Can I point something out to you? I honestly believe that the enemy does not want anybody in this room to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. There is a lot of distraction, a lot of craziness. If you didn't know what the distraction was a few minutes ago, Amanda's dad, they're probably going to pull the plug on him here in the next little bit, so be praying for them. That's a sad thing. It is absolutely sad, horrible. We understand that. But God is still God. You know what I've been praying all week long? Every bad thing that I heard about, every distraction, I said, Lord, do something amazing through it. I don't know what you can do, but you can do it. Far greater anything than I can do. Let's all stand, please. Who's coming back tonight? Amen. Our friends back here, Joseph, John, Jim. See them back there? They're from New York. They said they're with us for about a week, so hopefully they can come back tonight and tomorrow night. Amen. It's good to have them. Amen. Let's pray, and let's come back tonight. Amen. Father, we are again so thankful for your blessings. God, thank you for your sweet spirit this morning. God, thank you for an awesome word, for the foundation that was laid on this revival, great God. Continue to build on it, God, and we're still expecting amazing things. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Shake hands and be friendly.